John chapter 20, beginning at verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I've seen the Lord," and she told them that he'd said these things to her. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you've seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed."
Thank you, Pippa. Good evening. Oh, good evening. That's much better. Thank you. My name's Andrew. I'm part of the church family here. And we're going to be looking at this really important topic. It's on the screen there. Future proof. Why believe in life after death? It's a really important question because the likelihood is that all of us in this room or many of us in this room, or the chances are high that you're going to die. I mean, you might not, but I'm not going to talk about that now. But you probably will die. And the question is there life after death? It's a reasonable question. You may be thinking, well, it's a bigger question for you, Andrew, because you're older than I am. Yeah, I mean, the chances are I will what's the technical expression? Pop my clogs before you do. But death is an issue. And some of us are thinking now of people that we've loved very much and who we've lost. And the question is there life after death? It'd be great if you had that passage open in front of you, John chapter 20, page 1089 in the church Bibles. I would like to pray again. Let's pray. Father, thank you that we have your word in our hands. Please take our lives into your hands and speak into them. In Jesus' name, amen. So that's the question, is there life after death? Some of us are sitting here thinking, well, yeah, I believe there is life after death. It is interesting that a lot of people, even if they don't call themselves Christians, even if they don't believe in God, they will say things like this when someone has died, when they go to a funeral, they'll say something like, well, she's in a better place. People say that kind of thing. There's something in us that wants to believe there is something afterwards. It doesn't mean that means that there really is life after death, but it's very interesting that a lot of people say that there is something, there must be something after death. But the question is it true, or is it just wishful thinking? It's possible to believe things that aren't true, you know that. The issue is whether there's evidence for what you believe. Let me explain, give you two examples for this. Here are two examples of a belief, and for one of the beliefs there is evidence, and one of the beliefs there isn't evidence. Think about this with me. First of all, the evidence that Andrew Page, that's me, is English. There is evidence for this. I can give you evidence for it. I think I could convince everyone here that I'm English. My English is really good, isn't it? Yeah, there seems some doubt about it, but I think the evidence is quite strong. My English is really good. I quite enjoy standing in queues. It's quite astonishing. I'm basically a polite person. I think that's very English. And I have a British passport, a UK passport. I think there's evidence that I'm English. So I think if you weren't sure, I could convince you with the evidence that I'm English. That's a belief with evidence attached to it. A second example of belief is the belief that I have that Andrew Page is a genius. I think that's a really attractive belief. I really like it. It gives me a warm feeling inside, the belief that Andrew Page is a genius. But I have to admit, I sense the skepticism in the room. Because you're all sitting there thinking, yeah, but there's no evidence. And there really isn't any evidence that Andrew Page is a genius. So it's a belief that's just tosh. It's nonsense. It's rubbish. Can you see? The question with a belief is there evidence? Is there a foundation of evidence so you can believe that it's really true? Now, what about, is there life after death? What is the evidence that there is life after death? Well, I'm going to cut to the chase and say the number one piece of evidence that convinces me that there's life after death is the resurrection of Jesus. That's why partly we've been singing about that. That's why we read John's Gospel, chapter 20. It's about the resurrection of Jesus. I am convinced that the resurrection of Jesus is a historical fact. And because of that, Jesus died and he rose again. Because of that, we can be sure there is life after death because Jesus rose. And the Christian faith, of course, claims that everyone who turns from their sin and puts their trust in Jesus is forgiven now and forever, and will experience life after death with Jesus forever in what we call heaven. But the question is there evidence for the resurrection of Jesus? If there is evidence for the resurrection of Jesus, then we can believe that there's life after death. So let's have a look. Let's keep our brains switched on. Let's have a look at John's Gospel, chapter 20. Three main pieces of evidence that Jesus rose from the dead. And if Jesus rose from the dead, then there is life after death. Firstly, in verses 1 to 10, The tomb was empty. Have a look, verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. Now in chapter 19, the chapter before, Jesus has died. He's been crucified. And then he's been laid in this tomb. So Mary Magdalene comes and finds that the stone has been rolled away. And she must have looked into the tomb and saw that it was empty. Because look at verse 2. She came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. Incidentally, the other disciple is almost certainly John, who wrote this gospel. When he says that he's the one Jesus loved, he doesn't mean he loved me more than everyone else. It just means that John never could get over his surprise that Jesus loved him. He was astonished that Jesus loved him. So she came to Peter and John and she said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and John run to the tomb. Now John is younger than Peter, so he gets there first. He's fitter and he's stronger. He bent over, verse 5, looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Can you see that there's no body there? And can you see that the cloths that were wrapped around Jesus' body and around his head as well, they weren't in a thrown into a corner in a bundle somewhere. They were still there. Still there in the place where Jesus' body had been, but it was like Jesus' body had gone through the material and was no longer there. The grave clothes were there, but the body of Jesus was gone. The tomb was empty. Verse 8, finally the other disciple, this is John who's writing this, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. Now look at the end of verse 8, this is really important. He sees that the tomb is empty, he sees the linen clothes there, the grave clothes, and he saw and believed. In other words, the evidence of the empty tomb made him think, wow, Jesus has risen from the dead. He saw and believed. The first reason we can be sure that Jesus rose from the dead is that the tomb was empty. And I just want to say something about the empty tomb. It's a historical fact. There is no way that the Christian faith would have spread the way it did if the body of Jesus had still been in the tomb. There is no way that could have happened. If everyone knew that the body of Jesus was in there, in the tomb, rotting, there's no way people would have listened to this message, because the message of the resurrection was right at the center of the Christian message. So it's a historical fact that the tomb was empty. The question is, why was it empty? People give about 5 explanations for the empty tomb. I just want to go through them. This may be a help for you if you're not very sure about the resurrection, but it's also a help for you if you already are sure, but you've got friends who are skeptics and who say, "I don't really believe this stuff. Who says that the tomb was empty because Jesus rose from the dead?" Here are the 5 explanations. Worth remembering these. Now I'm standing here thinking, can I remember them? Explanation 1, the Romans or the Jews took the body away. The Romans or the Jews took the body away so that the disciples couldn't move the body, so that the body of Jesus was kept safe. That's what some people say. But that won't do as an explanation. Because when the disciples started saying a few weeks later, "He's alive, Jesus is Lord, he died for our sins, he rose again," all the Jews or the Romans needed to do was say, "No, no, no. Here's their Jesus. This is their Jesus. He's dead and he's smelly." And they didn't do that because they couldn't do that. No, doesn't make sense to believe that the Romans or the Jews took the body away, does it? Explanation 2, the disciples stole the body. The disciples stole the body. They took the body away and they thought, aha, we can now convince everyone that Jesus has risen from the dead. We'll steal the body. Then we'll say the tomb is empty because Jesus is risen. But that would mean that they were preaching something they knew was a lie. And even more than that, it would mean that they were, many of them were killed because they preached this message. It would mean that they died for something that was a lie. Would you do that? I mean, there are plenty of people in human history who have died for things that aren't true. I don't know, let's talk about some of the Nazis, some of the leading Nazis in the Second World War. Some of them died, and Nazism is not a, it's not true, it's not a right thing. But of course, they didn't think it was a lie. They thought it was true. But if the disciples stole the body and then said, Jesus is alive, then when they were killed for their faith, they were dying for something knowing that it was a lie. Are you getting what I'm saying here? Is that making sense? Great. Thank you for those six people who nodded now. It doesn't make sense to say that the disciples stole the body and then told lies about it. And what were they going to get out of it? Were they going to get rich? Were they going to get successful? Were they going to be loved? So explanation one, the Romans or the disciples took the body, the Jews took the body. Explanation two, the disciples stole the body. Explanation three, grave robbers stole the body. Apparently there were grave robbers in the first century, but if you were a first century grave robber, if this was your job in the first century, then you weren't interested in the body, you were only interested in the grave clothes. Because the grave clothes were one piece of material, not lots of different bits of material sewn together. This was valuable stuff. So if you were a first century grave robber, when you broke into a tomb, you left the body and you took the grave clothes. If it was grave robbers that took the body of Jesus, first of all, they chose a tomb where there was a guard on the tomb, not a sensible choice. And when they got into the tomb, they took the body and left the grave clothes. Duh. Does it make sense? It really doesn't make sense to say grave robbers took the body. Explanation four for the empty tomb. Well, Jesus wasn't quite dead when he was taken down from the cross. He was very nearly dead. He seemed to be dead. And they laid him in the tomb, and in the cool of the tomb, he came back to full consciousness and thought, I'm alive. I haven't died. I can convince the world that I've risen from the dead. I can convince the world that I'm the Lord. So he has a problem. He's wrapped up in these grave clothes. They were very tightly wound around the body. Not with your arms outside, but with your arms inside. So he's lying there. I mean, I haven't been crucified, but I couldn't get out of something that was really tightly wrapped around me like that. But suppose he manages it. He then has to push aside a stone that healthy women were thinking, how are we going to move this stone? This is a heavy stone. He has to get past the guard. Then he has to run into... Well, he can't run because he's got holes in his... Nail holes in his feet. And he's lost a lot of blood. And he's got to get into a locked room and somehow convince the disciples that he's the Lord of life and death. That takes a lot of faith. Much more faith than what I believe. It doesn't make sense. And the other thing to say is that the Romans pretty well invented crucifixion. They were experts. They knew their stuff. So when they said someone was dead when they'd been crucified, that person really was dead. That was explanation four for the empty tomb. And explanation five for the empty tomb, God raised him from the dead. God made the decision to bring Jesus back to life. What do you think? I think the empty tomb is very strong evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. And if Jesus rose from the dead, then it means that there is life after death. What's your answer? Why was the tomb empty? That's the first piece of evidence. First reason I'm convinced that Jesus rose from the dead and that therefore there's life after death. The tomb was empty. Now, secondly, a second reason in verses 11 to 18, Jesus appeared. You know the story, we've just heard it, but look at verse 11. Mary Magdalene stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been. They asked, "Why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said. "I don't know where they've put him." At this, I love verse 14. She turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. I don't think because Jesus had changed appearance, but I think she's got tears running out of her eyes. And Jesus is the last thing she expects to see when she turns around. So she thinks it's the gardener. And she says, verse 15, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I'll get him." And I love this, and this really has the ring of truth, doesn't it? Jesus said to her, "Mary." And maybe he said it the way he always used to say her name. And she suddenly realizes it's Jesus. He's alive. He's risen from the dead. A second reason we can be sure that Jesus rose from the dead is he appeared. He appeared to people. And I need to say again, this is a historical fact. This is not just something the Bible says. The Bible says it, but it's also true. It's a historical fact. In one of his letters, or in the first letter that Paul wrote to the Corinthians, the church in Corinth, he talks about the appearances of Jesus. He said Jesus died and Jesus rose again. And after he rose, he appeared to various people. And listen to one of the things that Paul says. He says, "Then last of all, Jesus appeared to 500 people at once, most of whom are still alive." Now that's a really dumb thing to say if it wasn't true. If it wasn't true, Paul would have said, Jesus appeared to 500 people at once, and sadly, there was a lot of flu last year. They've all died. No, he says, 500 people at once, and most of them are still alive. In other words, if you read that letter in the first century, you could say, "Paul, I want some names and addresses. I want to speak to people." Oh, we can be sure this is a historical fact that Jesus appeared. One of the things I'm famous for in Above Bar Church, there aren't many, is that one Easter Sunday, many, many years ago, I stood at the front of the church on Easter Sunday morning and ate a daffodil. And people found it very difficult to believe that I was actually doing it, but I really was eating the daffodil. I'm not going to repeat that tonight. I'm far too old for games like that now. And I ate the daffodil. And then I said, imagine that you go home afterwards and you say to your next door neighbor, you'll never guess what happened in church this morning. Someone at the front of the church called Andrew, he ate a daffodil. Well, they wouldn't believe you because they would say, people don't eat daffodils and definitely not in church. Incidentally, they are poisonous, so don't try this at home. But you could say to your next door neighbor, come here next Sunday. And you could bring them up to the front and they could stand at the front and say, how many of you were here last week and saw Andrew Page eat a daffodil? And it wouldn't quite be 500 people, but 500 people would put their hands up and say, yeah, I was here, I saw him eat a daffodil. Then they might believe. Well, it's exactly the same thing here in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 6. Jesus appeared, the risen Jesus appeared to 500 people at once, most of whom are still alive. It's a historical event. Jesus really appeared. The tomb was empty. Jesus appeared. And the third reason we can be sure that Jesus rose from the dead, the third piece of evidence that Jesus rose from the dead and therefore there is life after death, is this. In verses 19 to 29, the disciples were transformed. They were transformed. This will be very quick, but just have a look. Look at verses 19 and 20. Fear turns to joy. Verse 19, they were locked in a room for fear of the Jewish leaders. And then Jesus comes to them, and at the end of verse 20, it says the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Fear turned to joy. I'll give you some more transformation of the disciples. Guilt turns to forgiveness. They were guilty, they felt guilty, but Jesus gives forgiveness. Verse 23 talks about forgiveness of sins. And look at verses 24 to 29. It's the story of doubting Thomas. Most of us know that story. He said he didn't believe, and then he met Jesus, and it changed everything. Doubt turns to faith. So fear turned to joy, guilt turned to forgiveness, and doubt turned to faith. The disciples were transformed. And I have to say it again, and I want to spell it out. That is a historical fact. Something happened to change the disciples. Because don't forget, when Jesus was arrested and crucified, their world, the disciples' world, fell apart, didn't it? All their hopes were in smithereens. Is that English, smithereens? Well, all their hopes were gone. They were crushed. They ran for their lives, didn't they? So something must have happened. Something must have happened, which meant that a few weeks later they were standing up in front of crowds of people and saying, "He's risen from the dead. We've met him. He's conquered death. He's paid the price for sin. He's the Lord. He's the King of Kings." Something must have happened to transform the disciples. What do you think it is? I think the most logical answer is it was the resurrection. They met Jesus. They were transformed. And therefore, we can be sure that Jesus rose from the dead. I am so, so happy that my faith in the resurrection of Jesus doesn't just depend on some stories that I've been told or some stories I've read in the Bible. It said this is historical fact. The tomb was empty. Jesus appeared. The disciples were transformed. It's a historical event. And therefore we can be sure that Jesus rose from the dead. Can I ask you, do you think Jesus rose from the dead? Do you think it's true that Jesus really rose from the dead, that the grave clothes were still there, but he went through the grave clothes, he conquered death? Do you think that's true? I think it is. And if it is true, it means that there is life after death. And it means that the whole Christian faith is true. It means that Jesus really did die for our sins so that we could be forgiven. Wow, this is great stuff. Do you know the Bible says, the New Testament says, when God the Father raised Jesus from the dead, he was actually saying to everyone, "He's done it." When he died on the cross, he really did pay the price for sin so that you can be forgiven and become my friends forever. He's done it. If Jesus had stayed dead, we wouldn't know whether he'd paid the price for our sins. But now we know it because Jesus rose from the dead. This is stunning stuff. I could almost be enthusiastic about it. So there is life after death. Jesus proves it. And the great thing is that we have the opportunity to say yes to Jesus. The New Testament says, if someone turns from their sins and put their trust in Jesus, then they are forgiven. They are God's friends. They are God's son or daughter now and forever. And it means this, and I'll talk about me because it's easier because I know me very well. I went to school with me. I'm a truster in Jesus, right? When I die, that may be tonight, or it may be in 20 years' time, or it may be sometime between then. I suppose it may be after 20 years' time. That's a horrible thought. Anyway, when I die, I will go straight to be with Jesus. I will be with Jesus. Not because of what I've done for God, but because of what Jesus did for me when he died on the cross. Wow. So this is not me standing here and saying, I'm so good that God's going to have me in heaven. This is me saying, I trust in what Jesus did on the cross. So when I die, I'm going to be with Jesus forever in heaven. And the Bible says I will see him. And when I see him, I will be like him. Now, I can hardly imagine what that must be like, but it means that I will still be Andrew Page, but I will be the perfect Andrew Page. I will be the Andrew Page that God originally imagined when he created Andrew Page. Don't worry, I will introduce myself to you again. But I will be the perfect me. And if you're a truster in Jesus, then when you die, you will go to heaven and you will see Jesus and you will be the perfect you. Wow, why would you not want that? It is staggering love that God did all that for us. He sent Jesus to be our Savior so that we could be forgiven now and forever. Future proof. Why believe in life after death? Well, if you have any doubts about whether there's life after death, look at Jesus. Look at the empty tomb. Look at the fact that he appeared to people after his resurrection. And look at the fact that the disciples were transformed. Believe that there is life after death. And then start worshiping Jesus and trust Jesus. Make the decision that you're going to say to Jesus, I trust you. I believe you and I trust you. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for rising again for me. Because one other thing about the resurrection of Jesus I need to say. The resurrection of Jesus means that he's here this evening. Not physically, but he's here by the Holy Spirit. Jesus is here. And you can open your heart up now to Jesus. You can be doing it at this moment. Maybe for the first time, maybe for the 1,000th time, and you can be saying, Jesus, thank you that you died for me. Thank you that you rose again for me. I want you to be king in my life, to be king in my heart. And I thank you that there is life after death. And one day I will see you and I will be like you. I am so looking forward to that. Let's pray. Just a brief silence in which we can make our own response to God. Maybe there's one thing that struck you this evening. Maybe about the empty tomb, maybe about Jesus appearing, maybe about the way the disciples were transformed. Well, talk to the Lord about that in the silence. Father, we thank you that it's true that everyone in this room this evening, at some point we've asked ourselves the question, is there life after death? And thank you that there is an answer and a clear answer. Thank you for the evidence that Jesus rose from the dead. Thank you for the empty tomb. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you appeared to the disciples and Lord Jesus, thank you that the disciples were transformed. We praise you. Father, if we're still asking questions, still not sure whether it's true, help us to keep asking the questions to find out whether this thing is true or not. But if we're already people who've turned from our sins and put our trust in Jesus, then help us to hang on to that. Help us to rejoice in that. Help us to worship you for your great love to us in Jesus. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.